Hello, my name is Mark Pifer. I'm a spiritual teacher and author. And I recently listened to this podcast on the Tim Ferriss show that had Sam Harris as a guest. And Sam read an excerpt from his book. Waking Up, I believe, is the name of the book. I own it. It's on my pile of books that I'm supposed to read. And I haven't gotten around to reading them yet. It sounds like an excellent book. And what, of course, attracts me to this book is that Sam has a background in neuroscience and was an atheist like my background and is also, quote, spiritual, end quote. And sure enough, in fact, there's a section, I believe, in that book because I perused it on the left and right hemispheres, et cetera, et cetera. I haven't read it yet. I'm sure it's fantastic, as most of Sam's work is. But the excerpt that I want to talk about that he reads from his book is about an experience that changed his life where he took the drug ecstasy and he went into a state that I now know that I've been in for 7 years. Now, I can't claim the state is identical because I've never taken ecstasy, nor do I have any need for it. I'm making this assumption based on his description of the state. Actually, of what happened while he was in the state. The state is not necessarily the state of taking ecstasy. This is a very specific state that he experienced while on ecstasy. And I've been in that state for, well, about 7 years now. And in fact, I've been in it so long that the listening to the podcast reminded me that I once wasn't in it. And it kind of has helped me to see that in teaching others, I have to reach back a little bit farther and remind myself that in egoic consciousness, ego-centric consciousness, this is a rare state. It was rare enough that it changed Sam Harris's life. So I'm going to let Sam talk about the state, and then I'm going to interrupt him and make various comments for my own students or for anyone else who happens to come across this that is interested. So I'm going to let Sam speak now.
In the winter of 1987, I took the drug 3,4-methylenedioxy-N-methylamphetamine, MDMA, commonly known as ecstasy, and my sense of the human mind's potential shifted profoundly. Although MDMA would become ubiquitous at dance clubs and raves in the 1990s, at the time I didn't know anyone of my generation who had tried it. One evening, a few months before my 20th birthday, a close friend and I decided to take the drug. The setting of our experiment bore little resemblance to the conditions of Dionysian abandon under which MDMA is now often consumed. We were alone in a house, seated across from each other on opposite ends of a couch, and engaged in quiet conversation as the chemical worked its way into our heads. Unlike other drugs, with which we were by then familiar, marijuana and alcohol, MDMA produced no feeling of distortion in our senses. Our minds seemed completely clear. In the midst of this ordinariness, however, I was suddenly struck by the knowledge that I loved my friend. This shouldn't have surprised me. He was, after all, one of my best friends. However, at that age, I was not in the habit of dwelling on how much I loved the men in my life. Now I could feel that I loved him, and this feeling had ethical implications that suddenly seemed as profound as they now seem pedestrian on the page. I wanted him to be happy. That conviction came crashing down with such force that something seemed to give way inside me. In fact, the insight appeared to restructure my mind. My capacity for envy, for instance, the sense of being diminished by the happiness or success of another person, seemed like a symptom of mental illness that had vanished without a trace.
This sensation of sanity is a very common sensation from shifted consciousness. And Adyashanti often likes to talk in terms of maturity, which quite frankly, in the 7 years that this has been true for me, is just more and more clear. It seems like, honestly, I've grown up. In the same way that in childhood one sits around hoping for Santa Claus to appear and now says, well, if I want such a thing, maybe I'll go work at McDonald's and buy it myself. It's just a different way of viewing the universe. In the same way that it'd be hard for me to sit around hoping for Santa Claus to appear as an adult, it's hard for me to go back and look at the way that egoic consciousness experiences this universe as an adversarial, potentially hostile universe in which I need various strategies and beliefs in order to survive. It just seems insane. In the same way it would be insane for an adult to sit around waiting for Santa Claus to bring them what they want. And indeed, many people would say to that person, you still believe in Santa Claus? You still believe in magical elves making your desired object and dropping it down a chimney? A guru sees egoic people as insane. It's impolite to say so, of course, and it would be very unpopular, and one might be nailed to a piece of wood for saying it. But it is, in fact, true. This idea that egocentric, fear-based consciousness, the little me, as Eckhart says, and believing that I am that little me, that little abstract character I've invented in my head, is in fact a form of insanity. No more insane than if I thought I was Napoleon Bonaparte in my head, and somebody would say, okay, well, you're insane, because someone else has in history thought they were Napoleon Bonaparte. And when they did it, it was sane, and when you do it, it's insane. No, you should be Mark Pifer. Then you're sane. The character in your head. If you believe that, well, then you're sane. Well, all of that seems insane to me now. So, now I'll let him continue in his own words.
I could no more have felt envy at that moment than I could have wanted to poke out my own eyes. What did I care if my friend was better looking or a better athlete than I was? If I could have bestowed these gifts on him, I would have. Truly wanted him to be happy. Made his happiness my own. A certain euphoria was creeping into these reflections, perhaps, but the general feeling remained one of absolute sobriety and of moral and emotional clarity unlike any I had ever known. It would not be too strong to say that I felt sane for the first time in my life, and yet the change in my consciousness seemed entirely straightforward. I was simply talking to my friend about what I don't recall, and realized that I had ceased to be concerned about myself.
And so here it is. Now, Sam doesn't make this distinction, but the self he's talking about is the lowercase s self of spirituality, the little me. No longer concerned for my self, my small s self. It's interesting that just that one thing allows love to surface. Love is always, underneath that, constant, direct, and available. And it's covered up by these concerns of the small s self. And through ecstasy, and through insight, he eliminated that. He eliminated the monitoring and the constant referencing self. Small s referencing that the mind creates while it's running the story of me. And Alan Watts likes to talk about enlightened states as having a lot of absences, a lot of things that are no longer, that are in egoic consciousness that are now absent. And so it's interesting that Sam Harris now mentions a few of the things that have gone away, because it is, in fact, as you've heard many times if you've been around spiritual teaching of this kind, it is a letting go of, not an addition to, that creates enlightenment. What do we let go of? We let go of the small s self. What are the components of the small s self? Well, Sam is going to list a few right now.
I was no longer anxious, self-critical, guarded by irony, in competition, avoiding embarrassment, ruminating about the past and future, or making any other gesture of thought or attention that separated me from him. I was no longer watching myself through another person's eyes. And then came the insight that irrevocably transformed my sense of how good human life could be.
And so we come to the insight that changed his life. Now, the experience so far could easily be described as love thy neighbor as thyself, a fundamental teaching of Christ that occurs multiple times in the Bible. He is, of course, referencing a law that already exists, and so the teaching was already prevalent in the Jewish community. However, the truth of it, seen directly, love thy neighbor as thyself, can really be stated as love thy neighbor as if they were myself. That's the view through it. Because he no longer had self-interest. He was connected to his friend through love. He was loving his neighbor, in this case, his neighbor on the couch. And that insight will be profoundly impactful. Egoic consciousness, however, will like to turn that into specialness. Okay, that neighbor on my couch who is now my, quote, best friend, something that Sam had already said he was. Now, egoic consciousness could walk away from this and say, okay, this person's special. Much the same way when we have a romantic response for somebody on a first date or something, we say, okay, now this is the special person. We've had this romantic response. I'm, quote, falling in love, and now this person is special. Of course, that romantic love is a more of a clinging type of love and not really the love that Sam's talking about. Because in romantic love, we have innate wiring that makes us possessive and clingy and fight off other potential mates. And this really isn't the same. So the words love and love are not exactly the same. That's why there's the distinction of romantic love that's often pointed to in spiritual teachings. Sam isn't romantically in love with this man. However, the brain could easily, if this were it, and he, say, popped out of ecstasy, it popped out of this state, say, wow, man, I really like that drug because it reminded me of how much I love you, how special you are. And that's certainly an interpretation, because that's a special interpretation that the ego likes to create, because if that other individual is special, well, then by proxy, maybe I'm special. I'm real. The small me gets to be real when it identifies another small me and says it's special, either as someone I love or someone I hate. It really doesn't matter. The ego is absolutely fine with either one of these distinctions, because then it gets to be something. It gets to be real. Without this second part of Sam's insight, the ego could easily get away with that. But now Sam sees something that erases the ego's ability to make specialness out of just his friend and just his love for his friend.
I was feeling boundless love for one of my best friends, and I suddenly realized that if a stranger had walked through the door at that moment, he or she would have been fully included in this love. Love was at bottom impersonal and deeper than any personal history could justify. Indeed, a transactional form of love, I love you because, now made no sense at all.
I love you because. If one has read my work, they know that I often talk about egoic love as bartering. I give you this, and therefore you give me this, and therefore I say I love you. Egoic friendships are almost all built upon this. Predominantly, the bargain is, I'm going to tell you my story of me, and you're going to validate it. If you invalidate it, well, then you're also useful as my enemy, somebody I have to get into a war with, a battle to see whose story is correct. And in fact, entire cultures have gone to very, very bloody, long-lasting wars over this very thing. Eckhart Tolle likes to call this competing narratives. This is my God, no, this is my God. The irony, of course, is that In the case, say, between Jewish and Muslim people, they're talking about the same God, the very same God, because it comes from the same philosophy tree. They're just using different names. However, it doesn't matter, does it? This is now my story, and I'm willing to kill you over it. But this bartering that says that if you agree with my story, now you're my friend, is not real love, is it? It's not the type of love Sam was experiencing for his friend, because his friend wasn't doing anything. His friend was just sitting there. His existence, his mere existence, was lovable. That's something that's really, really astounding once you see it clearly. And again, as I said at the beginning of this, it's been so true for me for so long, I'm starting to forget what it looks like not to have it. But that's someone, really, something and nothing, to be honest, if you really want to look at it accurately, deserves love. Interestingly enough, once you see this truth, you'll start to see that many, many, many creatures have this state. And in fact, it is the base state of the universe. I'm not sure if I should go into all that, but because I could diverge here for half an hour. But I will say that if you look up, or look, pardon me, look down at the eyes of an infant, or look down at the eyes of your dog, that you'll see that this state that they love you just because you are is pretty common, is in fact a base state. Now, the dog and the baby don't have an egoic me, a mind-based me that they've invented, and they certainly don't have a very loud, chatty mind talking over it with constant stories and beliefs and narrations. And so they're in direct contact with this. They know through direct perception that they love you. And it's not personal. Sounds like, what? That means it sucks. Only to the egoic me does that suck. In other words, the love is not for you as an individual. It's for you as part of the whole. And in really, in reality, this love is for oneself. There's no separation. So, of course, it's true of anyone who might walk in. And as long as you don't limit yourself, you'll find out that it's also true of the wall and the tree and the ground and the clouds and nothing and anything else you might experience. And now, back to Sam.
The interesting thing about this final shift in perspective was that it was not driven by any change in the way I felt. I was not overwhelmed by a new feeling of love. The insight had more the character of a geometric proof. It was as if, having glimpsed the properties of one set of parallel lines, I suddenly understood what must be common to them all. The moment I could find a voice with which to speak, I discovered that this epiphany about the universality of love could be readily communicated. My friend got the point at once. All I had to do was ask him how he would feel in the presence of a total stranger at that moment. And the same door opened in his mind.
It's funny in my years of teaching how I've actually met resistance to the pointer that love is your birthright, love is your inheritance. And the reason why it was immediately apparent to his friend, viewing it through this lens, is because, indeed, it is the case. Love is the baseline state of consciousness. As I said and alluded to earlier, love is actually the baseline state of the universe. Now I realize that that's the type of statement that's going to meet with pushback. And I could go into a long-winded proof, which in the end, really, is not as useful as experiencing it firsthand, which is why doing the work is the pathway. Not knowing, not figuring it out. Not just because Sam Harris says it, and then, oh, Mark Pifer says it, and then Jesus says it, and Buddha says it. It really is useless. It is even useless to know as the right answer to the question, what is love? Oh, love is the universe. And love is my birthright. It's useless. Which is why first-hand Satori moments, like Sam's, are absolutely important on the path, and they come from, usually, from doing the work, in his case. And in the case of Geobaldi Taylor, there are other openings, and suffering is also another pathway where the mind lets go. And as it does, it reveals this layer. Geobaldi Taylor said, you know, this, she could see a world full of beautiful people that could come to this space at any moment and love one another and see that they're one, that type of thing. I'm not quoting her perfectly. And Christ comes out of the desert and is telling everyone, love thy neighbor as thyself. And we could go on and on about the various insights that came from these, as Sam calls them, spiritual crackpots and mystics. Well, he hasn't said it yet. It's actually in this last little bit, but it stuck out when I heard it. And the preface of my blue book, you know, basically it covers this, where these people weren't faking it. So what the hell were they talking about? As it turns out, it's your base consciousness, not clouded over by thinking. As Sam found out, that this really wasn't a special insight. This wasn't his. That the moment he pointed it out, his friends saw it immediately.
It was simply obvious that love, compassion, and joy in the joy of others extended without limit. The experience was not of love growing, but of its being no longer obscured. Love was, as advertised by mystics and crackpots through the ages, a state of being. How had we not seen this before? And how could we overlook it ever again? It would take me many years to put this experience into context.
How have we not seen this before? And how will we ever overlook it again? And yet it took him many years to put the experience in context. Which is what the mind loves. The mind loves things in context. Even mine, don't get me wrong, my mind still loves to have its linear, ordered, systemic interpretations. I don't listen to them necessarily. And as I said in the blue book, it's really excellent in closed variable situations where it can calculate. You know, I used to play chess, and there's only so many rules of chess, and so many rules in mathematics, and even language, of course. And that's the realm in which the left hemisphere does excel. But enough variables, and it starts to need to generalize. It starts to need to bulk things. And the larger the bulk, the greater the chance of error. Well, think about how much bulking it has to do to figure out who you are in this universe. It just doesn't do a good job of it. And in fact, it wasn't meant to have that job. The job's already taken. By the time you experience who you are, you already are. So, how could we have missed this? Well, what was absent? Go back to the absences. Follow Alan Watts' pointer and notice what he said was absent. That's a whole lot of nonsense talking over the top of this. It's easy to miss when there's a PR campaign that's constantly going in your brain, and it's demanding your consciousness, and more than that, you believe it. you believe that these strategies and beliefs are going to save your life. And so, they're worth listening to. They're worth clinging to. And they're more important than loving your neighbor. It's easy to fall back into that consciousness for most people. And enlightenment is the moment where you just don't buy it anymore. It's still active. It's still there. I can go in and access egoic consciousness. I just don't buy it anymore. It really feels like a childhood fairy tale. So, Sam had a profound experience. It's one that I actually experience daily. I don't say this to brag. I say this because I have to remind myself, as a teacher, what pointers are useful. And so I'm hoping that Sam's experience will be useful and that my comments on it will also be useful. Much love to you all. And thanks for listening.